watch the sports and all that stuff going on a little. We've had to have several conversations with, okay, what really transpired? Because I don't want it to affect your state. And the first time it was a little bit simple. Second time it was a little more serious. The third time it was like, okay, these are specific questions they had to be involved in what's going on with Louisville. So I imagine Louisville's going to get his smoking next 6 months or so. Those are the things that we all can't stand. And it's in the moment, it sounds great and wonderful, but the reality is that's what's tarnishing Louisville on a daily basis. So we want to be mindful of it and be careful about it. Social responsibility. Whether you like it or not, we're in the public eye. And I tell kids all the time that if something happens, I want to know about it before I read about it. I don't want somebody on campus to tell me you got to be about it. But I tell your coach, and your coach better tell me. All right, we'll deal with it because everybody makes mistakes. They're teachable moments. College is about teachable moments. Everybody screws up. I get a lot of opportunities to talk to a 50-year-old man who's been very successful in business. Okay, tell me. I mean, you guys didn't do something stupid when you were in college, or even after college. Okay, great. Don't judge kids today just because you're a little bit older. Right, we need to take those opportunities and those moments to be able to teach. We also need to have definitive outcomes. Right? We need to make sure that at the end of the day things are happening. So I did stupid things when I was in school. So I know, and I always laugh at my son because I tell him all the time, he's dead, you just don't understand. I said, dude, no, what you don't understand is I'm 47. I was 18 one time before. You've never been 47, so don't tell me I don't understand. When you get to be 47, then you tell me I don't understand. Well, Dad, it's just a different time. And I'm like, okay, is it involving choices? Is it involving girls? Or is it involving academics? Which one of those three? And he goes, I said, because it hadn't changed in all that period of time. If you're an 18-year-old boy, it's going to involve the choices you're making with your friends. It's going to involve some situation with a girl, or it's going to involve in law school. And if there's a fourth one, I haven't figured it out yet. Right? So tell me which one I can help you with. Because I'll walk you through it. We're going to talk. That usually sets him up. He gets frustrated and walks away. Right? But I'm going to make sure that that's instilled in him. And I treat kids just like they're normal. And I tell them, if kids flunk a drug test, right? I don't think smoking is a part of athletics. I struggle with that concept. But when a kid does, I always have the conversation about the fact, if you flunk a drug test, I suppose you're having a conversation with me. All right? And it's all about the fact that, okay, this can't be a defining moment in your life. If you want to keep smoking, you can be gone, because we're going to test you once a week for the next however long you're here. So if smoking is important to you, I'm going to bust your ass and you're gone. Okay? But if it's not, let's get you the help you need. Let's do the things that we need to help you be the very best you can be. And you say, well, why is that important to me? Because, again, I've been doing this for about 20 years, so I got a few different experiences. But I had a kid who very much looks like me. Always wore khakis, always dressed up, played soccer for us at Apple. And they found him on the beach dead in the Bahamas during spring break. And when they did toxicology reports, the stuff that was in his body, there was no way a human being could survive. And I got his mom coming up to me wanting to know why we didn't do anything to help her son. And I'm like, man, I don't know what you're talking about. Well, every one of his teammates and every one of his friends at school knew that he had a huge drug issue. Except for the coach. There's nobody wanted to tell the coach. He had actually written a paper for a class and this is where we had some campus conversation about that time. Like, he wrote an English paper, a 10-page English paper on how marijuana didn't affect an athlete's body. I said, that should have raised a red flag for somebody to say, hey, y'all may want to talk to this kid. All right? And so from that, we were able to do something. But it's, again, it gets back to choices. It gets back to you being the best you can be. And if we're going to invest in you, then I want you to invest in us. All right? It's pretty simple. And in the community engagement piece, I think we all understand the idea of notion of being a role model. I think it's hugely important for us to never forget where we came from. Our communities, our personal communities where we grew up, our high schools, clubs, the 80s, whatever we grew up in, all friends from home, but then also the bigger community, the campus where we live. And so we do a lot of community outreach. I'm not a guy, and I don't know how y'all do it here, but I'm not a guy that says, hey, every student has got to do 15 hours of community service. All right? I say, let's pick three or four things and do. I'd rather do fewer and do them better. You say, well, why is that? I say, well, I have a simple belief. The term community service, it really has two different definitions. All right? You think about it. Some Someone says you gotta do community service, what's your reaction? You know what, right? What if it's all of a sudden you got in trouble, instead of going to jail, you gotta do 50 hours of community service? You ready to do that?
Go to jail or?
Community service.
Community service.
Yeah, and so I always say that there's always a connotation that there's two definitions of community service. One is you're gonna do it from the service heart, your first reaction. You're gonna do something because I got an experience I'm gonna share with everybody else. Okay, versus the other one, I'm being forced to do this, and if I don't, I'm going to jail. I don't want anybody to ever look at dealing with whether it's homelessness, but really especially with kids. I never want anybody to look at it and say it's an obligation. I want them to look at it as, man, this is an opportunity for me to give my wisdom to my experience back to some kid who may or may not be teetering on the idea or thought of, I may go left or I may go right. I want to be that role model. I want us to invest in kids' lives. The greatest gift you can ever give somebody is your time. You can be the wealthiest man in the world. If you don't give your time to other people, then you give them that. You can be the poorest person in the world, but if you give your time, if you invest in other people, it's the greatest gift you can give. And so, no matter where we go and what we do, that gift of time is precious. And that's what I want us to take advantage of. I want us to make sure that we use it in the most appropriate, most efficient way possible, most effective way possible. If that makes sense to you. And then finally, I should have slide because I love it from a book I read. If you're a fan of any professional sport team, any college team, whatever, and they're not playing up to their potential, if you ask them these five questions, somewhere in there, there's your answer to why they're not playing, both are my business, won't make it. It's actually from a New York Times book on team building. It's the five dysfunctions of the team. Intensity of the results, the voice of accountability, lack of commitment, fear of conflict, or absence of trust. Every place that you've been where everybody's afraid to look at a teammate or look at a friend and say, man, you really need to get your act together. Because you don't want quote making them mad. And yet you're also not getting the result you're mad. I went to Georgia State. If you follow athletics at Georgia State, the basketball team is very successful. The football team is 5 years old. Random, trying to play Division I. Not very good. We're playing better this year, thankfully. Last year, we went through 4 straight weeks where we gave up 50 points. And I asked the coach, I said, Trent, I don't mind, but I'd really like to just sit and talk to the kids for 30 minutes. I don't want to talk to them for 30 minutes. I want to talk to them about this. I said, guys, let me explain something to you. Here's what's frustrating for me. Y'all have lost more games in the 2 months I've been here than I've lost in the last 9 years. Okay, to put it in perspective. All right? So I've watched very good teams function. I've watched very, very, very incredibly good teams function. And there's two things that bug me about you guys. Number one is that after a game, walk in the locker room and you just got smoked and kids are throwing their helmets, there's profanity, there's a lot of anger, there's a lot of angst, there's a lot of energy. I said, great, you just had 4 hours on the field to go prove that you were going to change something. And you did. The most energy I saw, I took 2 or 3 kids, I said, the most energy I've seen for y'all in the last 3 weeks has been in the locker room after a game. When y'all do all this histrionics. Why? That's embarrassing to you, it's embarrassing for me. If you got that much energy left after you play, you're that upset about it, then leave it out there. Leave it outside the door. Alright? Secondly, I'm gonna tell you, and I believe this, and I'm gonna use a football story for anybody who plays other sports. When I went to Appalachia, I was fortunate enough, let me tell you, when I was fortunate enough in college, I played four years for NC State and went 4 straight ball games. We missed winning the ACC championship 3 of those 4 years by a touchdown. I totaled 7 points and we won 3 ACC championships. Okay? So I played on some really, really good teams and I watched some really good guys. I figured it out one time that I had 17 college teammates who had a great NFL career. Not just a couple of golfers played for 3 or 4 teams over here, but guys who had careers playing in the NFL. I played with some great guys. Edwin Jeffries is the all-time leading receiver for Houston Oilers. More women's play. Alright? As an example. I watched these guys and I watched what they did. I didn't understand it as I started doing this as a job. I go to half, we won the 1AA championship in 05. We won the 1AA national championship in 05, 06, and 07. And we beat Michigan that year in 07. Everybody thinks it was a fluke. Our kids thought we were better than Michigan. And if you ever watch the tape of that game, we have a receiver named Ryan Quick, who was the first round pick. He was the first pick in the second round of the NFL draft in 2012, plays for St. Louis Rams right now. He dropped a touchdown pass. Second quarter and fourth quarter, we beat them by 20. We don't need to block a kid at the end. reason I was saying, I said, watch the tape, watch the game, right? But what those kids did, there was a culture, they believed in each other, and they fought for each other. But what they did, it started on Thursday, right? So I'm using my football story here. Thursday's a huge night on college campus to do what? We have fun, right? That usually means drinking and doing stuff, staying out till all hours. I watched guys hold their teammates accountable starting on Thursday afternoon, get ready to play a game on Saturday. And there's plenty of time on Saturday night to be a college student. There's plenty of time in the spring to be a college student. But on Thursday night, they started. And they weren't going to go out Tuesday night and Wednesday night, just too many things to do. But everybody on that campus is out on Thursday night at a big time. And the football kids are all in the meeting room watching the movie. And then they're all going back to their dorm for going back. And the seniors and the juniors help the freshmen and sophomores count. And I watched it for 3 straight years, and I watched the success they had on Saturdays. Well, guess what happened in 2008? 2008, we had a really good team. We were in a great cycle. Everything's running. But we had a lot of kids who now in 2008 have been a part of success, whether it was 05, 06, or 07, or some combination, walking around with huge rings. We bought the same rings in Auburn, Texas, and LSU ball. Right? But they never played. They watched all their buddies make all these plays, and they watched their buddies make all these commitments. And it's their turn to actually get out there and play. Well, guess what happened? Thursday night became more important for them to be a celebrity than it did for them to prepare for Saturday. And we lost. We lost in the second round of playoffs with a team that was better than the team that had no 5 or 7. And so what did the guys do? Well, what's different now than what we did before? Started back on Thursday night. And I told David, so we had the best team we ever had in the night, but our quarterback got hurt. He missed the first 2 games. So we played our semifinal game in Montana. Similar to what you guys went through here last year. We had a kid drop a touchdown pass last play of the game when we beat Montana, and we'll win our 4th national championship in 5 years. Ball went right through his hands because the snow inside was 9 degrees. Right? But those kids figured out how to invest in each other and started full flesh showing up to the field on Saturday. And so guys, when you get that kind of commitment with each other, you don't play for your coaches, you don't play for your school, you play for each other, and you guys will win some games. And that's, I use it to illustrate to you, that's a fundamental belief for me. I can't make you want to be successful. I can give you the tools, I can give you the framework, I can give you the parameters to be successful. But ultimately it's up to you. It's up to each individual person, right? And you choose to be a part of it or not be a part of it. And being a leader, we always focus on leadership. We always focus on it being positive, right? We always think, who are great leaders? Name a great, explain name a great leader. Name somebody else. Come on, history. He's not having good sports. Nobody here knows a great leader. Tom Brady. Come on, down. On the flip side, name a negative leader. Nobody ever thinks a leader should be a negative one. Hey, I'll fit it. I'll give you an easy one. Change the course of the world. Right? So leadership can be a positive and a negative. There are a lot of negative leaders in teams, business, the world. Positive leaders, you have to answer that question. If you truly want to be successful. And that's what we're trying to do. That's what I'm spending here today. I'll shut up. If you guys have some questions for me, I'm more than happy to answer.
I'll go on to the donation.
Yeah, we're 3-6, and with all due respect, we should be 6-3 or 7-2. So we got 3 games we can win. Put up a lot of points defensively, we played well. We lost 2 games early, we didn't think we could win. We should have. And we played Lafayette at home in the dome 2 weeks ago, and kid missed a 21 and missed a 19 and 21 yard field goals. And then he's also our punter. And not to throw it on him, but it's not taking this, but he decided to fake a punt in the 20-yard line, 7 minutes ago, up by 1. And put an incomplete pass. So we gave up.
Do you remember playing some of your players at Harvard State?
Yeah.
Alex Gray?
Yeah. Yeah. You know his story?
Yeah, he was a fisher.
Yeah. But you don't have to him when he's in school?
No, not really.
Call him and ask him.
I talked to him.
Yeah. Call him and talk to him. He got a little trouble.
He did. I know it was trouble, but I didn't really talk to him about it.
Yeah. But it's a great score. He's a good second chance to take it in, but he played well. Played really well. That's still following a little bit. Yes, ma'am.
What's the most rewarding thing about your job?
The most rewarding thing about my job, you know, so the front of the jersey says Georgia State, but the back of the jersey says Nicole Smith. I know Nicole Smith's story. And so I know her parents, I know her family, I know where she's from. I try to invest in the kids. And because I know that when she's playing softball for us and she has 2 home runs in the game, everybody celebrated the fact that she did that. Well, probably don't know, she had a brother that was in the hospital for 3 days. I know that. That's part of why I do what I do. I got to know the name. I got to invest in the kids and their name on the back of the jersey, the story. And that's the motivation. That's why I want kids to see success, because I know what their investment is. And you know the ones that, frankly, have all the talent in the world and aren't giving most of it out, they can. And then, yeah, you know the ones who are like the classic overachievers. And those are the ones you root for. Have a lot of fun with them.
How do you usually approach problems within the staff? Where you have staff that has a problem with another staff member or something like that?
You ever seen a Virginia football game? You ever seen it look up? V? There's one side of the story, here's the other side of the story, the true shoes in the middle. That's all I always joke about. I actually have a Virginia home in the office for that reason. That's all I can. I want to hear from you, but I want to hear from you. It doesn't matter if it's staff, it can be coach, player, whatever. People. In this role, you get presented a lot of problems. And one thing I've learned over time is that most times people have thought about it for an hour, 2 hours, 3 days, a week, whatever it's manifested in a period of time, and they're asking me to make a judgment or decision or thought after 5, 10, 30 seconds. And so I've learned, and give me a chance to think about it, let me figure it out, let me talk, hear both sides, and kind of you always find the truth in it. But I've always said, I had a great mentor one time tell me that if things really piss you off, don't react to them in the moment. Sleep on them. 24-hour rule. You wake up the next day, if it's really still bothering you, then go deal with it, confront it, don't let it fester. Because it's only bothering you, whoever else is, and they're not really thinking about it. But if it's not really bothering you, then it really wasn't worth worrying about. So I'm not a very reactionary person. I have been at times, and that's usually got me in trouble. But I really try to think through it. But I'm also a very big believer that I can solve it. If you're 2 of y'all in a fight or argue, I can solve it for 5 minutes. I can tell you you're right and you're wrong. But I haven't solved anything because you guys are going to still deal with each other and work it out. I'm going to force the 2 of you guys to work it out. And I've unfortunately been in a situation where people couldn't work it out and they wanted me to choose, and so I chose both of them. We got 2 new people. You know, so you got to figure out that it's the world we're living in.
You said you read a lot. What are some of the books that you would consider ones that maybe you've reread or ones that are very instrumental to the formation of who you are?
For our age or for their age?
Both.
Yeah. There's a guy in Atlanta named Tim Elmore who's a sociologist and he's a national speaker. He's written a book called Generation IY. It's about 150 pages. It costs like $12-13 on Amazon. I will tell you, y'all read it, you read it especially, but it talks about this generation. You got a generation on my way, or not, and I come from iPhones, iPads, and all the technology piece of it, all right? And it talks about this from a coaching standpoint, and if anybody on the team thinks about missing, that there's basically 2 types of kids who are playing sports in college. Kids who come from affluence, meaning mom and dad have had every resource possible to get them all the training and all the different travel teams and coaching and all this other stuff. Where they're coming from, abandoned situation, whether it's a parental situation, whether it's and they had opportunities where people didn't believe in them. There's a whole socioeconomic piece of that, and then you're asking everybody to merge together, right, with all these different life stories. And he does a great job of talking about here's how you handle and manage people who are different. If you think about it, in college, everybody comes together because the coach would recruit you, because he thinks, well, there's talent there, there's athletic ability, there's also character there, and there's also the ability to lead the school. So you're trying to blend this multicultural family, which is the best part of what we get to do. And so I've always been a big fan of this. There's Steve Jobs, the guy that started Apple.